So we are continuing with the series of talks on the Song of Awakening by Yongjia, a very prominent early Chan master. During the Tang Dynasty. And we have been talking about the views of Chan, kind of like the compass that guides the practice. Views, particularly the view of awakening, from that perspective, relating to the world, relating to oneself. So I've picked out a series of verses. So the Song of Awakening is written in poetic verses that deals now with practice. And I'm not going to be covering every verse, so I'm kind of skipping around the most important ones. And then the following section, maybe it'll take several weeks before we get to that. But once we get to that, the next segment pertains to post-awakening practice. Okay, so right now we're just on the practice part. Right? We've kind of gotten rid of the big screen in the back where we post the text so we can facilitate more people sitting. And but the downside is you all don't have the text. It's all online, so for future talks, first and third Monday, you can print them out and come here, or just listen. So I'll read the section, and I'll provide some comments on it. So the text goes, "This priceless treasure has inexhaustible functions, bringing benefits and responding to conditions without being parsimonious. The three bodies and four wisdoms are already perfect in their essence. The eight liberations and six supernormal powers are the mind ground's seal. For the superior, one breakthrough accomplishes all. For the middling and the inferior, the more they hear, the less they believe. You only need to discard the dirty garments within. No need to flaunt your diligence to others. When criticized by others, let them wrong you. They will tire themselves trying to burn the sky with a torch. When I hear abuse, it is like drinking ambrosia. Let criticisms dissolve, and suddenly you enter the inconceivable. If you regard criticism as merit, the critics will become reliable friends. Do not hate those who slander you. How else can you manifest the unborn power of compassionate forbearance? So tonight we'll try to cover these passages. So the first four lines. This priceless treasure has inexhaustible functions, bringing benefits and responding to the conditions without being parsimonious. The three bodies, four wisdoms are already perfected in their essence. The eight liberations and six supernatural powers are the mind ground seal. This is actually a critique of the traditional Mahayana frame for the path to Buddhahood. Most of us come to practice, come to Chan Zen practice, because we have encountered some difficulty in life. This may be stress, this may be grief, or just vexations. Constant cluttering of the mind with thoughts racing and emotional roller coaster. So we call that generally vexations. So we come to practice very self-involved. Yeah, it's natural, but we're just really caught up with ourselves and all the things that we're experiencing, and we seek relief. Once a person gains some calm, stability, then kind of really getting into the practice, then this kind of self-referential involved mind, heart will start to seek after extraordinary experiences. So what are these extraordinary experiences? Well, the text lists some of them. The three bodies, the four wisdoms, the eight liberations, and all the six supernatural powers. What are these things? Most of you probably don't know them, but they probably sound enticing, don't they? They sound good. I don't know what they are, but six supernatural powers, the eight liberations. Can I get some of that? I need some liberation. There are eight of them. The important part here in this passage is actually the last line. It lists all these the wonderful attainments, like dangling candy in front of children, Snickers bar, I don't know what kind of candy people like these days. Chocolate. Twix. Truth. Oh, truth. I thought you were talking about the candy bar Twix. Truth. Yeah. Truth. You know. Awakening. You know, dangling in front of people. These are all kind of like candy bars. When I say the last line is most important, usually people just kind of bypass that. All they hear is three bodies, four wisdoms, eight liberations, supernatural powers. The last line is, they are all part of the mind ground, the mind ground's seal. Seal is refers to like a stamp seal. Stamp seal. It replicates in kind of perfect resemblance, perfect mirroring of whatever's on the seal. It's kind of like a mirror. Kind of like a mirror. So all of these things that practitioners seek after, they may come to the practice because of, in short, suffering. Once they are relieved a little bit, the craving mind turns to wonderful things that they gravitate to. You can think of it as opposite of suffering. Truth, awakening, eight types of liberations, six supernatural powers. But what this passage points to is that all of these things are actually contained within the mind. These things are mere reflections, imprints, like a seal, like a stamp seal, imprints of that which is already complete, replete within the mind. Now, what is the three bodies referred to? I'll talk about them one by one. They are Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, and Nirmanakaya. These are said to be the three bodies of the Buddha. Dharmakaya refers to the body of truth, the body of reality. Sambhogakaya means the body of beatitude, sometimes referred to as the reward body. Reward. Reward of what? Having attained Buddhahood, the reward of merit and virtue. And the third, Nirmanakaya body, is the body of form, the actual historical Buddha that walked on earth 2,500 years ago. So the three bodies, of the three bodies, the Dharma body refers to the truth that the Buddha has awakened to. And that truth contains all the merit and virtue, which is the second body, and is attained by the historical Buddha, Nirmanakaya body of the Buddha. That's the third body. It doesn't mean literally body in the physical, corporeal sense. But these three are actually one. Now we can reify this truth body to be something outside of us, something actually attainable, something graspable, identifiable. But actually, the true body is not truth at all. It is the body of each and every one of us. as it is, never separate. And this is the truth that we're already free. Not some reified lofty notion of liberation. It refers to, in this very moment, even in the midst of our suffering, of our proliferation of thoughts, vexations, even in the midst of that, freedom is already there. Freedom is already there. It's not something to believe in, have faith in, although it's necessary to have faith in this to begin the practice. But it's something concrete, realizable right now in this moment. How does this truth manifest? This truth manifests in the simple freshness of this moment. Even in the midst of our vexations, when we are bogged down with our thoughts and feelings and negativity, the freshness and instantaneousness of those thoughts, those feelings, as they arise, moment by moment by moment, itself readily manifests, demonstrates this freedom. And it's like this room with its spaciousness and its immediacy, concreteness, manifest its true nature, which is open and free. But when we're in this room, it is us, our own attachments, that are caught up with the furniture, the people. That's all we see. We don't really see the spaciousness, the freedom of this room. We see the walls. We put up the ceiling. We put up the walls. We see the people, and we make discriminations based on all the manifest forms. Does that make sense? It's not that freedom or spaciousness has somehow left. You have to get rid of the form, and then you chase after freedom. It's already here. How to untangle our discriminations so that we actually recognize this freedom instead of being caught up with all the comings and goings of wandering thoughts, discursive thinking, which is all that we've ever known. The monologues that we have in our minds, the feelings that we embody, and the conclusions that we draw from these feelings. These are all furnitures. So when he talks about the three bodies, the body of reality, beatitude, and corporeal form, these three are never separate. They're always together. The truth is always readily available. This is from the perspective of Chan, his interpretation. Now, other traditions, they actually talks about these three bodies as something attainable, as if we don't have it now, as if it's absent now. They also give a time frame to acquiring this. So those positions are actually dismantled and critiqued from the Chan perspective. The second set, the four wisdoms. these four wisdoms are actually from the Yogacara school, the consciousness only or mind only school of Mahayana Buddhism, which details and elaborates on the features and functions of the mind as having four distinct layers, and which can be subdivided into eight levels of consciousness. So the first to the fifth consciousness refers to the consciousness. Before I go on, I have to ask you to bracket the Western notion of consciousness. Can I just put it aside? The Buddhist notion of consciousness is that which emerges based on interaction of causes and conditions. In other words, it's dependently arisen. So the first five refers to consciousness that arises from eye, ear, nose, tongue, body. Consciousness, eye consciousness, ear consciousness, olfactory consciousness, tactile consciousness, and so on. How do they arise? They arise on the basis of five sense faculty, coming in contact five sense object, and giving rise to corresponding consciousness. At this level, this consciousness refers to, it's more clear if we understand it as cognitive moments. So in this tripartite relationship of sense organs, sense objects, giving rise to this corresponding cognitive moment-to-moment-to-moment-to-moment awarenesses, cognitions or consciousness. The sixth consciousness refers to the interactions of the sixth sense faculty, coming in contact with sixth sense object. That is the mind faculty. In Buddhism, mind actually is a sense faculty. So what are its sense object? Thoughts, shapes, visualization, all the symbolic functions of the mind, able to produce numbers, to see color, see shape, engage in language. That's the object of the sixth sense faculty, giving rise to cognitive moments of awareness of engaging in them. So the material basis of the mind is, by modern science, would be like the brain, right? And the central nervous system. But scientists these days are talking about also another center of nervous system, the gut. They also speak about the nervous system between the heart and the brain, the vagus or the vagal nerves, something like that. You know, so basically the nervous system. So that would be the material basis. Right? So modern science is kind of revising its previous notions of the brain, solely of the brain as the center that sends out information. Right? So scientists are saying now there's a reciprocal process. It's not only here, but a large portion is also here in the heart. So all of these are having these conversations. Right? So, but together, these would be the material basis. Now its objects.
I guess from science would be the synaptic firing generating data, the interpretation of data. The old model would be, you know, thoughts, feelings, and so on, which we tend to think of it as here, right? Now, if we kind of taking the modern science interpretation, probably just using data, right? Cognitive, psychosomatic data would be the sense object of mind, giving rise to kind of momentary consciousness. So that's the sixth consciousness. But there's something very distinct about the sixth consciousness. Right? The first five, it's very straightforward. The sixth consciousness has a distinct function of discrimination. Discrimination. Because it's able to compartmentalize, analyze, categorize, reify, solidify ideas based on words and language, and is able to construct the world through this discriminatory lens. This is a friend, that is a foe. This is good, that is bad. Right? So it's intricately connected to the symbology of language. And this is what I was talking about. This is all that we've ever known. All of our monologue, all of our notions and ideas, we have a deeply, deeply vested interest in them. So we truly believe in them. Taking the furniture as the space, right? We mistaken our notion of things for how things actually are. One person can see something as good, another person can see it as bad. Each of us identify and attaches to our own discriminatory labels, right? Judgments. Now, so that's six. What is the seventh and eighth? Seven and eight are kind of extensions of the six. Of the six. Within this discriminatory function, the Buddhist, specifically the consciousness or mind-only school of Mahayana Buddhism, identifies this constant self-referentiality in the center of all the discriminations, in the center of all the judgments, all the feelings, all the thinking process. There is this perpetual self-referencing that lies in the center. Right? Now, if we discriminate between this is good, that's bad. I like, I don't dislike, I dislike. When we discriminate, in the center of that is the I. In other words, it's not possible to discriminate without self-referencing. So what is that sense of self-referencing? It's the assumption of a me, I, my that lies at the center of all these experiences that is separate. All these are actually just functional assumptions. It's not actually true. Self, me, I, my, as separate, permanent, and independent. Right. So whenever we have some discriminatory notions and ideas, when we examine into the discriminatory notions and ideas themselves, when we look into our own discriminations, these three are always present. Independent, permanent, separate. Assumption of a me, I, mine that's in the center of it. And this causes havoc to all of our relationships. And this is something that the Buddhists identify as the seat of suffering. Okay. As long as the self-referencing is there, this Buddhists would call it a delusional, false attachment to something that's actually absent, that's actually not there. As long as that is there, all of our relationships, all of our choices will be hijacked by this and will inevitably lead to conflict. Right? As long as there's me, I, mine there, there's always going to be othering. Right? There's always going to be discriminating. So that's the seventh one. So as extension of the sixth, you know, the discriminatory consciousness in the center is this. What is the eighth? The eighth is this to put it simply, it's just this continuation, this continuum, mental continuum. There needs to be a mental continuum in order to account for the processes of cause and effect. Right? Processes of cause and effect within our mind. For example, a child growing up abused, abandoned, or maybe told that the child is never good enough, will lead to, as a cause, you know, day in, day out, weeks by weeks, month by month, year by year, will perpetuate and shape all the subsequent or the next moments of consciousness, right, of choices, of discriminations, right, leading to this whole mental continuum of feeling a certain way, growing up, having grown up, feeling unloved, unseen, unheard, low self-esteem, not worthy, so on and so forth. So what counts for this continuum is what's called the repository consciousness. In Sanskrit is alaya, the alaya vijana. It's like a Santa Claus bag. Whatever choices, karmic choices, decisions, and actions we dump into this bag, this bag will retain it, such that if you throw a particular type of karmic presence in there, then most likely, you know, you reach down, you grab a present out of the bag, probably a high percentage you'll get that. So if we constantly dump in this bag, I'm not good, I'm not seen, I'm not heard, I'm not loved, then most likely, you know, what comes out of this bag is that kind of perception of the world. So the alaya is like the Santa Claus bag. This bag itself is empty. It's just a convenient way of accounting for, you know, cause and effect in our mental continuum. So these are the eight layers. What does that have to do with the four wisdoms? Now, these eight layers of consciousness are divided into four parts. So the four wisdoms, the alaya, Once a person's awakened, meaning the seventh consciousness, the most important, the heart, the core of this eight layers of consciousness of our mind's heart work, heart's work, the seventh one. Once the self-referencing is dismantled, one no longer functions on the basis of this delusion that there's a separate, independent, permanent sense of me, I, mine, separate from you. Once this is experientially dismantled, not intellectually understand. If you intellectually understand, it's just another idea. An object of the sixth discriminating consciousness. A symbol, words, language. It doesn't mean anything. But once experientially, a person realizes awakening, then this constant self-referencing actually vanishes, disappears. Does that mean the whole world disappears? Nothing matters? You don't know your name? Not at all. Everything is still there. And your mind still functions. Your sixth consciousness, discriminatory mind, still functions. Everything works. Doesn't mean there's no cause and effect. Cause and effect, the mental continuum still goes. Except it's no longer established on this false assumption. So, when that happens, the repository consciousness becomes the great mirror wisdom. The great mirror wisdom. The seventh consciousness becomes the wisdom of equality. It's no longer othering people. It's no longer selfing oneself. Equanimity. The sixth consciousness, which is discriminatory consciousness, turn to the wisdom of wondrous observation. So it still has the function of discernment. Red is red, green is green. When you drive a car, you don't say, I'm enlightened. I don't need to follow conventional rules. I can just, you know, drive when it's red light. You don't do that, right? So all the conventional reality is still there. And the mind is able to discern, but it's no longer self-referencing. So the function, that function of consciousness, that layer, becomes the wisdom of wondrous observation. Now, all of you I know have experienced this. When our mind is so caught up with ourselves, when we are so caught up with ourselves, all we see is just whatever concerns us. So imagine, and I know you have experienced this, when the mind is quieted, free from kind of preconceived ideas of this and that, you actually correspondingly notice things out there in its minute detail very clearly. Have you experienced this? You know, you walk in nature, kind of quiet, and you notice little dandelion flower on the side of the road, or little butterfly. If you're clouded here and cluttered, your best friend can walk right past you. You don't even know it. You're just kind of self-absorbed. Does that make sense? Right? So that's why the discriminating consciousness becomes the wisdom of wondrous observation. Less here, cluttered, correspondingly, everything becomes readily apparent in its own clarity, in its own space. And the first five consciousness becomes the wisdom of unrestricted activity. Unrestricted activity. So, that is to say, our sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, thought consciousnesses, you know, usually restricted, very limited. So upon awakening, it doesn't mean that if you used to wear glasses, upon awakening, unrestricted, I can actually see everything so clearly without glasses. It doesn't mean that you still have a bad eye, right? But unrestricted means that you're no longer discriminating based on what you see, what you hear, what you smell. Whereas when the self-referencing is there, it's constantly selecting, picking, choosing, creating obstacles, right? Creating blind spots. Right? So without the self-referencing tendencies, and our senses function freely. So that is the four wisdoms. In other words, all eight layers of our consciousness begin to function better, accurately, with precision, yet without a center. It becomes freer. Is it beginning to sound like candy now? I want some of that, right? The eight liberations. Eight liberations are particular ways of or methods of cultivation in traditional early Buddhism. It's part of the subset of 37 aids to awakening, to enlightenment. So these eight are basically liberation on the basis of an attachment to form and recognizing the impurities of the form. So it refers to a particular method. What method is that? Meditation on impurities. The second, liberations. Liberations on the basis of absence of desire on the impurities of form. So whether we are attached, whether we are unattached when contemplating forms, recognizing its impurity. Impurity here means its defilement, its potential to pollute the mind, to give rise to craving, aversion, and deluded thinking. Third one is liberation on the basis of purity with regards to all form. I'll explain this a little better in a moment. The fourth one is liberation through realizing infinite space. The fifth one is liberation through infinite consciousness. The sixth is liberation through realizing the absence of existence. The seventh is liberation through the state of neither thought or absence of thought. And the eighth one is liberation through the extinction of vedana, or consciousness, sensations. So the eight liberations was a are still practiced, but it refers to a particular method of practice called contemplation of impurity. which is typically the contemplation of a corpse. Okay, this may sound pretty gruesome. So the purpose of which is to dismantle attachment. So for a man who attaches to sensual pleasure, beautiful forms, women, for example, the practitioner will meditate on the corpse of a female body. Right? So if you meditate on that long enough, basically you're not going to crave for form anymore. So because of the presence of desire, right, the first liberation, the person meditates on this. Until the person reaches a point in which there is no desire, but one still meditates on impurity. That's the second one. Now, when you meditate on a corpse, what happens is the corpse becomes decomposed, right? But before it gets to that, it gets bloated. The corpse, the flesh will change color, and after it changes color, some areas of the body will become bloated. And then eventually, the bloatedness will burst and maggots will come out, right? And the body will start to decompose all the way until all the flesh is gone, because you're meditating in the elements, right? Rain, snow, heat, the sun, until it's just pure white bones. At that point, the person progresses and meditate on the purity of originally that which is impure, of the form, which is the pureness of white bones, until the white bones actually turns to just luminous light, because you're focusing on whiteness, white, white, white. The flesh is all gone, all the dirt is gone, and the rain has washed away everything. It's just white, white. So the mind becomes, enters into higher levels of meditative absorption. And that's when we begin with from the fourth one up, meditation on infinite space, okay, and then infinite consciousness. So they roughly correspond to the eight types of samadhis or meditative absorptions. So these are the eight liberations. Okay. Now, mind you, this is what the text is critiquing. It's not actually promoting these practices. It's not promoting these practices, nor is it promoting, you know, the three bodies of the Buddha, the four types of wisdoms. What it's saying is all these things are already complete, already replete within the mind. And these things are like reflections of a mirror, reflecting. They have the potential, and it's already here. But continuing, next it talks about the six supernatural powers. So the six supernatural powers are, the first one is supernatural power of ubiquity, which means the body can simultaneously be present at different locations. And then we have the divine vision, divine hearing, awareness of the minds of other people, knowledge of past lives, and the sixth one, which is most important, the power of extinction of vexations. Vexations. So Chan, now why would vexations arise? Vexations arise on the basis of self-referencing, self-attachment. So when the self is absent, the vexations of greed, hatred, ignorance, along with all the subsets, jealousy, arrogance, and so on, we have nothing to latch on to if the I, me, mine, is absent. So that is something unique within the Buddhist tradition. So it values the sixth one. The previous five are recognized by all spiritual practices. And so here the text is talking about all these things. Are really nothing to seek after. There's something already replete within oneself. They are mere reflections of the potential of the mind. Right? So it's like water. It's like water. The water has the potential to have, you know, big waves, like tsunami waves. Like recently, I don't know if you know, Germany and Belgium have bear witness to flood. Sometimes the water, although its nature is wetness and clarity, but the way it manifests because of causes and conditions, it could be devastating floods that kills hundreds of people. So it could be as like a limpid, clear lake, transparent to the bottom, or it could be a towering wave. Right? So all these potentials are not outside water. That's what this text is saying. Like the room, going back to the analogy of the room, the spaciousness of the room. It has the potential to encompass everything. I should say, maybe not the room, because the room has walls, grounds, and ceiling. But just the space itself has the potential to encompass everything, but also can be devoid of everything. But the space, or the spaciousness, you could say, contains everything. All these potentials is contained in space. Like the water, all the potential, the tsunami, or the floods, or the clarity of the soothing autumn pond, all these potentials are contained in water. That's what it's positioned on. On the three bodies, four wisdoms, eight liberations, six supernatural power, all these are contained within the mind. So now the important thing is awakening of the mind to realize this inner freedom. Now, so, in summary, it's very easy, you know, to get caught up with these so-called spiritual attainments. Right? Most people come to practice because of, you know, they want to overcome some anguish or problems and difficulties. As soon as that settles, the same greed, aversion start to translate and start to gravitate to these spiritual attainments, right? And that becomes a source of attachment, it becomes source of obstacle, source of another kind of suffering. So all that, the Chan's perspective is to not make a big deal out of all of this. Get to the heart of the matter, realize the innate freedom. These things manifest, come and go in their own accord. Okay. So that should be the takeaway. Now it talks about, the text continues to talk about superior, middling, inferior grades of practitioners. And then the next four lines talks about criticisms that we encounter with other people. Let them tire themselves out like a torch trying to burn up the sky, right? Which is impossible. And give some advice about daily life. Yeah, daily life. Criticisms that we encounter. So we'll continue to talk about that in the next talk. And today we cover the first four lines.